story will be about this sniffer.
Benjamin, there were four is when large numbers of families, of communities started to resettle in different areas, a lot of them in places that were very significant to the Jewish people, such as Ofra, Shiloh, Beit El, places that we read about in the Bible, okay? And they chose the same names because in our eyes this is a continuity of what has been here and stopped, unfortunately, and now we are renewing that. And today when we speak about the lives of Israelis who have chosen to live here in Judea, Samaria, and the Jordan Valley, the numbers are of 430,000 Israelis, not including Jerusalem, East Jerusalem neighborhoods, who live in over 150 towns, communities, four large cities, religious, secular, ultra-Orthodox, Ashkenazi, Sephardi, Ethiopian, Russian, all the different immigrants to Israel have a representation over here, South Americans, we have as well. Most of them living what we feel is a very normal life, as much as we can. I'm a second generation. My parents came here in 1987. They came from England. They were looking for a small community in the hills, in the center of Israel, in a historical place of significance. And they chose Neve Tzof, which is where I live today, a community that is celebrating 40 years since its establishment, raising a third generation. Most people have to commute every day and work all over Israel in any possible position that you can imagine, in universities, economy, high tech, military careers, teachers. We have a very, very large percentage of education positions over here. Half the population in Judea and Samaria is below the age of 21. So there's a lot of youngsters, a lot of babies, a lot of new schools, new kindergartens that we have to establish every single year. And half our annual budget goes to formal and informal education. We see that as a very important target, taking care of the next generation of the education. We're also proud of very high recruitment percentage to the Army and National Service. Here in Benjamin, over 92% to recruit for 1 or 2 or 3 years of serving the nation and the country, which we are very proud of because it means that all this all the effort and investment in education, it pays off because the next generation does feel very connected, very motivated, very part of the country, of the state of Israel, very ideological. Although you always find a variety in opinions also here. If you're looking to find an opinion of a settler, today when we have a newspaper that wants a view of a settler, they understand that a settler from Shiloh and a settler from the secular city of Ma'ale Adumim would not be the same perception. Or if you find another guy who lives in Beitar Elit, which is an ultra-Orthodox city south of Jerusalem, because we're speaking about a population of 500,000 people, that this is their life today. One more thing, and then we'll open up for questions. That's up. Lots of numbers and things that I said about the Jewish population. We are not only Jewish Israeli people living here. Speaking about numbers, it's a bit hard because there's no exact number of how many Palestinians actually live in Judea and Samaria. But if I speak again about the area of Benjamin, which is the regional council where I live in, within these boundaries, there's a population of about 350,000 Palestinians. The largest city is Ramallah, which you maybe saw driving over here. A new city that is being built and spoken about quite often is Rawabi. I would say that besides Ramallah, a lot of the population lives in the villages and towns, more traditional population, I would say, as opposed to secular, high-tech city type of population. A lot of people work either within recognized Israel or within Israeli settlements over here. Numbers, a few tens of thousands. And why am I mentioning this? Because people who work together, who shop in the same areas, that is the place where it's relevant to speak about coexistence.
We are touring Shimon, the most diverse capital city of Israel, existed for 367 years. And today there's a settlement in it. We are within Israeli settlement in the West Bank, so take a look around. We just left the settlement and we're talking about how, like, there's like this tightrope of understanding perspective here in Israel and narratives and realities, which is this course's name. And it's basically just saying that, like, while settlements like these are cool, like this is a holy site, like you can understand it, like not a lot of these are understandable, especially in America, when they're not following international law. At some point, Israel's going to get big enough and strong enough.
Oh, window, sorry.
And it's going to become a
wire. Water bottle. I'm just like,
it's going to become a big enough problem that it's going to, I mean, they're treating international law as a joke and the international community as a whole. Yeah, some people do that, but they follow it. And here, they're just like getting away with it. What happens when Israel is bigger and stronger than Canada or the U.S.? Do you have commentary? Alex's commentary.
Sustainable situation. Obviously, this is the most important biblical land, and it doesn't give you the right to just say it's going to exist like this for 70 years without a resolution. I think that's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
I don't understand that part either.
What's your point on it? You have anything?
Me?
Yeah. What's your thought on the settlement?
No, it's indeed. The thing is that they are saying, this is what's making me so confused.
Okay, guys, I hope you enjoy.
Uh-oh. We got a little announcement.
Let me see commentaries at, like, we're in a quiet place.
We're in a quiet place? Oh, just talk up and it'll be fine. Yeah, I hope you enjoy the visit and also the pizza. That's all next to Yael. Yes, thank you for the pizza.
Now we're going to meet other people and our residents. This will be our last stop.
We're going to the Palestinian refugee camp, right? Yeah,
sure. No? We cannot hear you. Can you speak up?
Okay. We're going to another point.
Another settlement.
On this trip. We're going to visit a touristic initiative called Hani Badir. They will explain us. And it's another.
You surprise me. Why you put yourself in a very vulnerable situation.
Yes, Jeremy. You want to ask something?
Yes. No. Who's he talking to?
Judith.
Oh, okay, go ahead. Keep going.
Are you filming?
Yeah, yeah.
This is a question. This woman gave a very good example. She is in a very vulnerable situation because of her nationality and because of her gender. Because of her nationality, she's an Israeli in the heart of the West Bank. So she is vulnerable, so she can have Palestinians, angry Palestinians attacking her, justifying that she's occupying the land. And then within her society, she's not protected by the Israeli laws. She said, she explicitly said, oh, I might have an issue when I'm pregnant with my manager because Israeli labor laws doesn't apply.
Yeah, the law doesn't apply here.
So why, for God's sake, you put yourself in a very vulnerable situation? Like, imagine if her manager decided to harass her.
Yeah.
You know?
What do you do?
What do you do? So I don't get why you would put yourself in a very vulnerable situation, on a double one, because of your nationality. Mm-hmm. And because of your
and financial one as
yeah.
well.
You're yeah.
You make $500,000 for a house that you could potentially
yeah. yeah.
And as Alex was just saying, you know, you cannot use someone to justify this because, you know, if we accept this justification, if we accept that you can use the Bible, you can use the Torah, as a Christian or as a Jew, justify this. So why we're claiming Muslims who are justifying Quran and their attacks?
Yeah.
Because we said, oh, you cannot use Quran to justify this. Okay. So he can say, oh, and you cannot use Torah or the Bible to justify illegal settlements yeah. and illegal from the Israeli perspective.
And some of these settlements are on places like Shiloh, which is holy, which like can kind of make sense. But other settlements are just places where it's pretty and they've just decided to stake down a farm and say, this is mine and I'm Israeli and I can be here. but under the international law of occupation, it's completely illegal. And as he was just saying, like, they recognize that it's illegal, but under Israeli law, under their Supreme Court, there's authorized and unauthorized. And so, like, sometimes they authorize these settlements, which Shiloh isn't, and sometimes they don't they don't authorize them, which is one we're going to right now, is an unauthorized settlement. And it's a very big, big matter in international relations right now. And like I said, it could be an extremely big problem in the future. So my opinion on it is that they should get the heck out of every area that isn't religious. They should give the Palestinians back their land and get out of their territory, because what Israel is doing is penetrating these barriers that they built themselves, by the way, and then building the barrier around these new settlements. As the Israeli Defense Force builder, we talked to the builder of the wall earlier, and he was just saying, hey, look, I'm gonna build this not according to the 1967 line, I'm gonna build it according to the settlements. And on multiple occasions, he was talking about how he made adjustments to this wall based on where Israelis were living. And like, I get that displacing people is a problem, but like, drawing a line that doesn't exist on a map is a problem. So yeah, we're gonna keep going. Matt, do you have any thoughts on this before I close this commentary?
I didn't really like Parsh said like in 7 years to see any changes at all. I'd expect something to say like you figure out a two-state system. She really didn't care about it.
She said she didn't even want to even consider the two-state system. She wanted to consider, what did she call them? Provinces.
Yeah.
She wanted to make them
better. She said that there was a movement called the Federation Movement.
Federation.
Yeah, was it do like the United States or like Canada?
Like
the provinces or the states. Right. And I don't see that working at all. A Palestine is occupied not under their, like, will.
I mean, it can relieve some.
And so they're not going to willingly become a state. Because eventually, well, I mean, maybe if they become a state, then they'll have the right to secede. And that may be a better solution. But that would be long. And if its intentions were to become a state of Israel, a state of the part of Israel, and then secede, then that would probably end in another violent war in this place. So really, like, no solution exists right now except for the two-state solution, and Israel's encroaching on that by putting all these settlements down, authorized or not. So yeah, time to go look at the next one and see. Yeah, they really do. And like I was, you know, describing that I said a little bit earlier about this tightrope. Like I'm on this tightrope, and sometimes I like lean towards the Israeli side, and sometimes I lean towards the Palestinian side. But I've definitely not flopped over yet. But they've all got good arguments. They're all really strong opinions. But and like I get it. That's why this is a problem. Nobody swayed to the left or swayed to the right for a long time, except for the United States, who literally vetoed every Security Council resolution regarding this. But yeah.
I think Tennessee, like, Jews got kicked out of Europe. Yeah, they had no place to go after Europe.
Yeah.
And then they said same thing with Palestinians.
They just did the same thing. And but like, this was their hometown. Like, this is their home, and I get it, they're coming back to the land of their forefathers. And then the Palestinian people finally found their nationality, gave themselves a name. And now we've got two peoples inhabiting one land, so it's not pretty.
I will start with this instrument, that this is a Persian instrument, and it's mentioned in the Bible as the psalterin. In Hebrew, psalterin, it's piano. And this is the ancient piano. If you will open a piano, you will find the santur in it. All the string, all these sticks that call hammers, and it's gonna play for 4,000 years. Thank you. And from this instrument, 4,000 years ago, I will play the youngest instrument in the world, the hang. It exists only 18 years. It's made in Switzerland based on other instruments that from the Caribbean, from the name of this country, from Trinidad.
Trinidad and Tobago.
Yeah. Thank you.